What is up, health enthusiasts? It's Coach Lambie here for Working Weights LLC, your guide to strength, health, and all things nutrition. Joined as always by my co-host, Dwayne Ulrich, aka Poppy Dworl.
Poppy Dworl on the house. In the house. Ah!
Today we're talking about red light therapy and blood glucose.
Red light. Not red light district. It's red light therapy.
Yes, not red light. I'm gonna cut in TLC red light. Red light special. All right, man. Yeah. Okay. So, kicking this show off, let's start it with some reels.
Reels. Here we go. Then you mop them, you can't stand them, then you drop them, you pop them, cause we pop them like over red and vodka.
First things first, I'm the realest. Realest. Drop this and let the whole world feel it. Let them feel it. And I'm still in the murder business. I can hold you down like I'm giving lessons in physics.
Right, right. Right.
You should want a bad bitch like this.
Huh?
Drop it low and pick it up just like this.
Yeah.
Cup of Ace, cup of Goose, cup of Chris. I heal something worth a half a ticket on my wrist.
On my wrist.
Taking all the liquor straight. Never chase that.
Never.
Stop like we bring an 88 back.
What?
Bring the hooks in with a bass at. Champagne spilling, you should taste that.
Fast lane. You already know. I'm in the fast lane. From
LA to Tokyo. That's awesome.
I'm so fancy.
Yeah.
Can't you taste this, girls? Remember my name. How to blow.
I said, baby, I do this. I thought that you.
That's actually pretty impressive.
That is super impressive, man. I was going to say, I think I've seen that trio before on AGT.
Yeah, that'd be actually quite hard. She has changes all her face and everything.
Oh, it was impressive, man. That's impressive.
I figure I'd just get right into it. You know, there's always these Bible verses that people want to read at weddings, and I just felt like the most appropriate one is Genesis 2:25. Adam and his wife were both naked. And they felt no shame. So have fun tonight.
Oh, so cool. Check this out. Pretty cool, right?
Why are you watching this?
I'm always watching stuff like this.
You are weird.
Weird. Every guy wants one of these.
It's so fake.
I see these things all the time in real life.
Psst. If you had light in front of you, you wouldn't even know what to do with it.
I've been in one.
And?
Yeah, you're right. I didn't know what to do.
That's why I saw.
You're just a hater.
Well, how would you feel if I watched stuff like this?
Oh, I want all that meat in my mouth.
All right. Yeah, coming strong today.
Did Christy send you this?
Yeah. Genesis 2:25. We're going to cut to a short intermission while Dwayne composes himself.
I can't believe Christy sent you this. How am I supposed to talk about the red light district now?
I know, right?
Scene.
Scene. Things really come together on this show. All right, man. So we're going to talk about red light therapy and having an effect on blood glucose. And then pretty interesting little tidbit. You doing okay?
Yeah, it's pretty funny, Manny. I'm going to kind of have to explain that to Kathy. Baby, I had nothing to do with those videos. That's all Christy.
Huh. Yeah, she sends those to me, and I have to put them into the make a separate video of them, but I don't really watch it, so I'll just grab it and I'll copy the link and then put it into another thing, and that downloads the video for me, and then I'll just import them into CapCut and then create a thing, but I don't watch them until we get on here, so.
For all of you that are listening and not watching, you really need to find somewhere where you can see that because it's
The link for the YouTube is in the show notes, so.
oh, there you go. There you go. Because it's like an honest mistake, you think, and then it's like, oh my gosh. Anyway, it's pretty funny stuff.
Yep. All right, man. Light stimulation of mitochondria reduces blood glucose levels, and I guarantee you there's one person out there going, the mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell.
Yes. This is kind of controversial too, the whole light stimulation thing with red light as opposed to any other light.
So the interesting thing that we're going to look at in this study here, it gets quite controversial. So I like it. Yeah, man. So this study, looking at using red light, LED red lights that produce a certain wavelength and exposure here, 670, I guess that's nanometers of light. And so there's a bunch of research in improving mitochondrial function that we have. So you can see it in flies. So they've done it in flies and they've done it in mice. So we got some animal and some insect stuff to go, base everything on. And so this study actually takes that research, goes a step further, looks into human beings and what they did. Here is it took 30 people from Helsinki, I believe. They're healthy participants. So the results from this, we don't know if there's going to be a straight conclusion that can be made across all populations. So people are going to, hopefully this might help with diabetes, pre-diabetes and stuff. But the people in this population are healthy. They don't have any diseases. They didn't take weight or BMI, which is kind of weird because it like you're having people come into the laboratory to take these OGTTs and you're doing blood draws and stuff. Like you can't just have them step on a scale. Like, I don't get it, you know? So anywho, yeah. So we're looking at red light that is, it's still within the visible wavelength, but it's near infrared. So infrared would be invisible. We can't see infrared. But it's still that red wavelength. You can see, when you turn on red LED lights, you can see the red light, right? So still in that wavelength. Took 30 healthy participants, and what they did, they brought them in, took some baseline measurements for glucose, oral glucose, or not oral glucose, blood glucose concentrations, fasting glucose, had them fast overnight for 10 hours, came in, did an OGTT, they took glucose samples before the OGTT and then in 15-minute intervals thereafter. They have it written down here somewhere. All right. So they did that at baseline. And then a week later, they had them come in for some red light therapy. Now, this is a randomized control trial. So what they did between participants, they had 30 participants. So 50 got the red light intervention, or 15, sorry, got the red light intervention. 15 got the placebo. And the cool thing about the placebo here, the way that they did this is they actually had the infrared LED thing, and then they had a like a what they call it, a boot or something that went over it and went on people's back, right? So the hood, sorry, is a hood. So let me see if I can get down here. Yeah, we also have respiratory measurements. But anyway, they had this hood over the red light thing, and it went onto people's skin so that they couldn't see the light being emitted, right? So both groups got the same treatment. Like you sat down, I guess would look like a tattoo artist chair or something where you can lean forward and they expose the skin on their back, right? And then they put this hood down and then they put the LED light on that. So everyone thinks that they're getting the light treatment, right?
Right.
Which is,
Right.
I think, is a pretty good way to placebo this. Because you like the only difference is either they're switching the lights on or they're not. Like, so pretty good deal.
Oh, I got the green light.
So, all right. So blood glucose concentrations measured at zero time frame, which was fasted. They come in and they did the finger prick and did like a normal glucose monitor that you could buy off the shelf, but it is a validated monitor. And then took it at 15 minutes, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, all the way up to 2 hours. All right. And then they also checked expired carbon dioxide, so the amount of carbon dioxide you're breathing out and your respiratory rate. And so the idea behind that is that if this red light is going to increase mitochondrial function, and so what the mitochondria are going to be doing is they're going to be producing more ATP. So they're basically looking to see if the mitochondria are using up more glucose. And that's going to number one be expressed in lower blood glucose levels, and then also you would have an increase in carbon dioxide in your respiratory rate. Okay, so took people in, exposed them to the light, or they didn't, and then they took their blood glucose measurements and their respiratory measurements, and what did they come up with here? So the blue line is the placebo. The red line is the red light intervention here. And so they have a couple different ways that they analyze this. So absolute blue blood glucose concentrations, we can see that they rose together at fairly the same rate here. The intervention had a little bit sharper rise, but then it stopped before the placebo group, right? And it started to come back down. And so you can see like all of these measurements are statistically significant from one another. And so in absolute terms, the red light group had a steeper rise in blood glucose, but it stopped sooner at a lower concentration. So this looks like it's close to 9 millimoles, where the intervention they got a little closer to 10 millimoles. And then it started to come back down sooner, and at the end they're pretty close to being the same. And then so in chart B here, what we're looking at is kind of they not only compared the placebo group to the intervention group, but they also compared individual responses, so each person's individual response. All right, and so we can see the same thing happening in that chart, and that one looks a little bit more significant. So when you look at the individual, so between each participant, the difference between the first time they came in and took these tests and then the second time they came in and took these tests, you see an even more significant difference there. And so
You
what they
notice
came,
you, you you
yeah.
notice the peak. You notice the peak on both of those for the people that got the red light. Well, actually, that's pretty. The peak on both of those lines, for the individual and the absolute, is right at 30 minutes.
Yeah,
For
yeah,
the
yeah, yeah.
red light and for the placebo is just about a little bit after 40. A little bit after 40 minutes. On so it's just that's just that's interesting. That's
Yeah,
interesting.
yeah. So it peaked a little bit sooner. And I think that that peak being at 30 minutes for the red light is just that it started to come down sooner, you know?
I
But
agree.
yeah, the
I
peak,
agree.
they rise at relatively the same rate. They are statistically significant from each other, but they're rising at just about the same rate there. But yeah, it just stops rising in the intervention group and starts to come back down a little bit sooner. So what they found, now, if we can remember back to the episode we did on the plant-based meat alternatives, and people were wearing the CGM, so plant-based meat alternatives compared to animal meat. People were wearing the CGMs and they were looking at blood glucose over the day. And so what everyone was caught up in, all up in arms over that thing was that there was a reduction of about 11%, if I remember correctly,
I
in
think it was 11.
the total area under the curve, right?
Right,
So for
right.
the animal-based products, that the total area under the curve, so the total amount of glucose that you were exposed to for the day was around 11% lower than the plant-based meat alternatives. And interesting in this one, what they found in absolute terms, oh, let me see. It's right here. Yeah. So area under the curve analysis shows a 7.3% reduction in total circulating glucose concentrations. So a 7% reduction in area under the curve. So you're being exposed to 7% less glucose concentrations here, and a 27%, almost 28 reduction in the post glucose consumption, rise in glucose levels. And so that's that peak that you're talking about there. It's almost 28% lower.
Wow. Wow.
Pretty cool stuff, right?
That is
Just
cool.
to think about being exposed to red light therapy. Now, here's the thing. This is the kicker. How much red light were they getting? It was 15 minutes. 15
Wow.
minutes, and they have the total amount of skin area, but it was just basically like the upper portion of your back,
Yeah.
right? So we can look at, oh, this is more blood glucose. This is a lot of the same stuff. Now, these are a lot of the different types of analyses they did. So they did several different analyses so that they could make sure that the changes that we're seeing in blood glucose and respiratory carbon dioxide would be, can't be accounted for individual variants or other things like that. Because they didn't do things like take people's weight and body fat tissue, and those things do have an effect
Right,
on these
absolutely.
measurements. Yeah, so
Absolutely.
they didn't take that. So then what they did is they did all these different types of analyses to make sure, to try and compensate for the lack of that data. And then we can see exhaled carbon dioxide here. So the placebo intervention, we can see that there is a lower amount of exhaled carbon dioxide. It is higher in the intervention group. So
Which would indicate.
it indicates to us that this red light therapy actually is increasing mitochondrial function. The
Right.
mitochondria is taking in more glucose. It is producing more ATP, and
Right.
then that is being expelled as carbon dioxide in the breath.
Right. Just while you're rolling, scrolling at your next spot. So they just did this on their back. And there's a lot of gyms. I know some chiropractor offices that are offering the whole red light therapy thing. And that's a full body thing for most of those. I just went to a gym recently, just checking it out. And their red light therapy is it's a full body thing. You get in there and you can sit down or but you most people will stand up. They stand up in there for like 10 or 15 minutes, which after a workout, I'm sitting down. But the point being is, it's a full body deal. It's not just your back. That's interesting. I wonder what that looks like in the data.
I would like to know too. Yeah, so these changes are obtained with only a 15 minute of exposure over
Right.
800 centimeter square tissue area.
That's amazing.
Yeah, which accounts for around 4% of the skin surface area. So not a large area on your back. So like I haven't looked too much into it until this one, the red light therapy, but yeah, there are a lot of gyms now. So they specifically, just in regards to this one and the references that they have in here. So we're really looking at red light that's around 650 to, I guess, 700 nanometers, those wavelengths in there. So I don't know about other wavelengths, whether or not a lot of these red light LED panels that we're getting are producing wavelengths within those ranges. And then we also don't really know Just from the data that we have here, like what kind of long-term effects we're having here. But what they are showing in this one is that even a single exposure, the single 15-minute exposure to red light had an effect over, around 5 days, which is interesting. Yeah,
Which makes you wonder if they, which makes you wonder if it's a full body thing, how much longer will that effect last?
Or is there more effect? If you expose more skin area, is there more effect? Or, I would assume that there's probably some threshold to of effect that we can do here, because the idea that you could just like continue to increase mitochondrial function just because you're exposing more skin, I don't know. You know what I mean?
I do. I'm interested also in, so we don't really know anything about the subjects that did the study, that were in the study, but who would benefit from does everyone benefit from the increased like, well, what about people who have a higher metabolic demand or lower metabolic demand, particularly like maybe from age or overall health versus, say, an elite athlete.
So those, it would be interesting to look into that stuff. Now they do say in this, it's important to stress this study's undertaken in normal, healthy subjects and not those that are diabetic. So we don't know, how much transfer this has to other populations. I think we could assume a priori that there would be some amount of transfer there. Now, and it could be the case that the more adiposity you have, maybe the lower effect you might see. You might even see more of an effect, though. I don't know. So that would be interesting to look into. So here's the interesting thing that I came upon in the discussion part of this study. All right. So I'm just going to read this here. So, whereas shorter wavelengths undermine mitochondrial function, exposure to 450 nanometers, which is a dominant peak in LED lighting in the built environment, results in significant and rapid reduction in blood pressure in humans and also a significant increase in heart rate. Both shifts persist during exposure periods. Experiments using 468 nanometers in human subjects similarly disrupted physiology, significantly increasing blood glucose levels during exposure. LED lighting is fundamentally blue dominant, as a short wavelength light is used to stimulate a phosphor element that then is perceived by the human eye to produce a wider spectral range of white light. Hence, lengthy exposure to them, so being LED lighting in buildings, in the absence of sunlight, may have significant long-term consequences in human health, including dysregulation of blood sugars. So, so is LED lighting in offices and stuff maybe contributing to this obesity epidemic that we're seeing? It's that's something to think about, huh?
And so we're talking about 450 nanometers to 468.
Yeah, so 450 to 470, somewhere around there, which I did a little bit of Googling on that, and that is just kind of like if you're buying LED replacement lights and even some fluorescent lights, that's basically the wavelength.
And that's the big push right now as well. Is and it's like, if you ever notice, I mean, and this is just anecdotal, guys. I'm just gonna throw this out there. But LED light has always kind of irritated me and bothered me because it does have a bluer tint to it. And even on cars, when you have cars with a high intensity LED lights, it's that bluish look, you know. There's all kinds of people have all kinds of reactions to that. Versus, I mean, just visually, I've read a couple of things where people become more agitated in those environments, even like in an office that's highly LED lit. There's an agitation. I haven't read anything about like the actual physical properties about like dysregulation like that. It's yeah. So what are we doing?
It is something to think about. So, like I didn't even think of that. Now you're bringing that up, and we think about all of these like industrial office spaces. So if you think about a call center, right, where there are no
Oh,
windows, it's a
yep.
bunch of cubicles, all the walls are painted white, the ceiling is those white tiles, and you have a bunch of bright white fluorescent lighting or whatever. And then speaking of reacting to lighting, like there are certain lights that make me sneeze. I don't
Oh,
know if you've ever
I
experienced.
no, I've
Yeah,
experienced
so
that.
there's like
It's
a
weird.
certain fluorescent lights will, yeah, if I'm in the room long enough, like most of the time I was in high school, there were certain classrooms where you could tell like the lights were different. And if I looked at the lights too long, I would sneeze. But yeah, so industrialized office spaces where there are, no windows, it's all cubicles, it's these really white, bluish white environments. The rates of depression, the rates of disease, the rates of overweight and obesity that have to do with those environments. And then you contrast that with some of the newer tech organizations like Google and Apple in California, where they're creating these buildings that are basically all windows, right? It's like a really open space. You might think of the inside of it being more like ancient Greece or something, where they really used, how the sun came, rise and set. That's how they position their buildings. Everything was, meant to increase airflow through the buildings and increase the light that you had in there. And a lot of the, Google, Apple, all these places have higher rates of employee satisfaction and lower rates of depression. People generally tend to have better attitudes. I think there's also, I don't know that it is the case, but maybe a case to be made that they do have lower rates of overweight and obesity and, things like diabetes and stuff. So, man, there may actually be something to this.
I agree. I agree. I'm kind of freaked out about it actually. Which
Yeah,
just is,
look at all this blue light behind me.
I know, right? I know, dude. You better wear some blue blockers.
I guess so, yeah.
Something else that just put me off onto. So there are circumstances. I'm just going to briefly mention it. I'm not going to go off and I'm not going to take a deep dive off into it. Somebody's going to send back, "Wow, Poppy Dworl is a conspiracy nut." I'm not, but well, maybe kind of. But anyway, there are certain lights and certain light generation devices that don't we perceive them as the light being constant. But the light's not always constant based on variations or fluctuations in voltage, whatever filament it uses, or what kind of gas it's using. And so while we perceive something as a constant light, sometimes the light's pulsing in intensity or even in an off-on, but mostly in an intensity. Imagine what that's doing to physiology or even mental health. Just think about it.
Yeah,
That's all
so
I'm gonna, that's all I'm gonna say.
I just looked up. So a lot of our devices use LED screens. You got TVs with LEDs, computers, laptops, phones. So I just looked up the wavelength for those. It's between 400 and 490.
Well, that includes 468 and 450.
That includes 450 and 460. So,
So
man, could
a
dev
good
yes. So
so a
could
good
that
data. A good data test. I'm sorry.
go
But a good
ahead,
data
yeah.
test would be what is the mitochondria and do those same tests on somebody that sits in front of a television for 6 hours a day versus, 20 minutes.
Or a computer screen, or
Are
just your
yes.
phone. So in this study, the red light was the area of exposure was 800 centimeters
Net
squared.
nanometer. Oh yeah. Centimeter square.
Yeah, so the area of skin, 800 centimeters squared. And the red light was 400 millimeters or so. That's about 16 inches away. So you think about when I'm holding my phone.
12 inches, 14 tops.
Yeah, so it's a little bit closer. My whole face is being exposed to that blue light, and it's for quite a bit longer of time than 15 minutes. Man, so that's kind of like I think maybe when there needs to be some further looking into on this.
Well, we talked about the blue light in our conversation about sleeping.
Yeah, that's true. So a little
Enough said.
You have the blue light blockers. You have so more to this than just meets the eye. Wow.
Truly,
What
truly.
a yeah. So that so the red light wavelengths that they used in here, so that is still on the visible spectrum of light that is within the visible spectrum of sunlight that you get. Okay, so this does make the case for people to get outside more
Yes,
often. Yeah,
absolutely.
you need to get some sun exposure to you.
Absolutely.
Make sure that you're wearing sunscreen.
And the argument would be there is, oh, well, the sun is so bad for you. And oh my gosh, it's just so bad for your skin and blah, 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 blah. We could just do a deep dive off in this. But so I've known people that lived and still live in places like, Alaska. I had a friend of mine lived in Point Barrow, Alaska, which I think is still the farthest point north, farthest U.S. settlement north. And it's like dark 6 months, 7 months a year. It's always cold, and they just have different issues up there. Physiologically, mentally, and because they don't have sunlight. I can tell. I went to a I'm not gonna go off into the story, but let's just say this. I've several years in a row, I went and I spent like a week in Emmitsburg, Maryland, and great place. However, in the winter, the sun doesn't come out. It's obscured by weather, just obscured by weather. And I know my personal behavior and mood and sleep patterns was changed. It was different because there was no sun. So and then I came back home and it was like glorious, the sunshine. We're naturally meant to be absorbing light from the sun. So we have to consider that as natural light. And there's a reason that the spectrum of light that's in that light from the sun, as opposed to LEDs, heck, even neon, fluorescent.
Yeah.
So
Yeah.
get out and get some sun. That's that whole diatribe led to this. Go
Get
out
out,
and
get
get
some
some
sun.
sunshine.
Get out there. Yep. All right, man. Well, I think that about does it. What an interesting little study there. A whole interesting topic. You have to look further into that.
We'll need to revisit it for sure.
Yeah. All right. Well, hope some minds were blown out there. I hope you guys got something from this. I think I'm gonna probably maybe look into one of those red light masks. I don't know. Maybe.
I might get a gym membership so I can go down there and bake my body in red
Baking
light.
some red light. All right. Yep. I will see you guys next time. Coach Lambie and Dwayne out.
All right, out.